title, but go out there and win it all over again. What do you make of it? How much are you looking forward to the new season? Any Hibs fans on the way to Easter Road? What are you thinking? Is it going to be a straightforward night? Are we all going to forget all about the so-called embarrassment in Andorra? Is it going to be comfortable? Or are you worried that we're staring down the barrel of one of the Scottish European qualification shocks? Do let us know. Motherwell are making signings, as are St Johnstone and other teams. Graeme Souness, some brilliant, really interesting comments from him today as well, Mark Wilson. It is properly all happening.
Well, it certainly is. It hasn't disappointed us. You know, the start of the summer is always a bit slow to get going, but I think this year was particularly fast, particularly when you look at Rangers and everything that was going on behind the scenes there. Michael Beale knew he had to rebuild the full team, you know, and he's certainly done that. Cifuentes, his ninth signing, something along those lines.
Absolutely.
So a lot of players coming through the door at Ibrox, and that leaves questions for others who are still there in place at Ibrox who need to be moved out the door. Listen, Brendan Rodgers, he's seen his team on plenty of occasions now. He'll know where he needs to strengthen if he does, because the majority is the same squad that won the treble last year, minus Jota, of course. But I'm sure Brendan Rodgers has his own ideas of trying to strengthen and win the title in a bit of style. And like you say, Gordon, the other teams doing their business as time ticks over. So it's always interesting. The first game of the season, like Daz says, they're seeing who's in the starting lineups, not just the Celtic and Rangers, but all the teams throughout the league, Aberdeen as well, putting together a nice squad.
Absolutely.
So very interesting.
Yeah, there's a lot to be said about signings generally. That one is brand new as well, if you like, breaking news before the show. So it seems like an obvious place to start, Rangers fans. What do you make of Cifuentes? Everything that goes into a new signing, you've heard all the questions by now. You think you know the way it works, how you see him fitting in, how excited or not you are, whether it's the final piece in the jigsaw or more to come. All the usual, give us a call. And anything else ahead of the new season, please do. But we should all be getting a bit excited by now, Gordon, surely. Thursday night. People always look forward to Thursday night. Two of the nation's sweethearts, Wilson and DL, gracing the airwaves with their knowledge and wit. And
you can now look in and watch
as well.
And the football's back. You know, it starts probably tonight for Hibs. Disaster of a result last week. They've got to turn that around. They don't want it to go off to a poor start and get put out already. But everyone's got their eye on the league campaign, Gordon. Obviously, Celtic kicking off at home. Rangers down at Kilmarnock in the later game. The teams will be very interesting. Both made a few signings. Rangers, obviously, 9 new players coming into the building. As a manager and supporter, you're just hoping they hit the ground running. I've been able to watch Rangers live last week. A lot of new players, a lot of new ideas of Michael Beale. And then I was, you know, fortunate enough to sit and watch James Forrest's testimonial the other night there. Brendan Rodgers, the luxury of having two teams, two 11s. A lot of quality players and a lot of competition for places, you've got to say.
How did you get that James Forrest testimonial, by the way? Did you subscribe? All money's going to a good cause.
There's someone sent me a stream. I put my iPad and I was very lucky I picked up. I couldn't understand how that happened. I watched Ghent last night as well. I don't know how I get Belgium TV as well. But
did you actually watch that game last night?
Yeah.
You must be the only person in Scotland that's watched that game or could get access to
I was very interested. It cost me $20.
You've got some cash.
It's great that he's now outing himself on TV as well as radio as well.
No, but I'm taking an interest in opposition. It'll be a difficult game for Rangers next week, but I think they've got to go over a hurdle of Rugby Park first and foremost. That's what all the Rangers fans will be looking forward to. But I think the two teams are getting in very good shape, because there's a lot of players out there making a claim for a starting place now.
Absolutely. 0141 951 1025. I thought we were about to speak to John. He seems to have gotten somewhere. I'll get him back in just a second. Oh, he's disappeared completely. The wonders of modern technology. We'll get John back in the not too distant future. It is a big night at Easter Road, as we've said. Signings all happening. We're building up to that kickoff as well. A 6-hour special for us on Saturday. Cannot wait for the competitive stuff to return. We've got lots happening for you tonight. We're going to give you the chance to win some cash a bit later on in the show. I'm very much looking forward to hearing if it is Gordon Dalziel in the hot seat, if he can even remember what his lie and his truth is. So it's one lie, one truth. I'll reveal a bit more about that later on in the show as well. So we're going to hear from all sorts of people today. Brendan Rodgers, I did say, completing his press duties ahead of raising that flag at Celtic Park at the weekend. So lots to get through. I don't know what is happening with John, I must admit. There he is, he's poised and he's ready. John is a Rangers fan. John, you've made some signings today, or one big one in particular, José Cifuentes. What do you make of that? Who knows?
Obviously nothing.
I heard him. He's
not interested.
Well, we should get the callers and FaceTime.
John, you're here. Take it away. What do you make of the signing today?
Sorry, guys. I thought Gordon had maybe wasn't he well there? We wasn't the fly now, and I was trying to talk to him there. So, I hope you're well, Gordon.
I'm John. Thank you.
Great stuff. Good to hear you back. Because you're the only guy that's got better patter on the show. So
exactly, mate. I totally agree with that.
Just a wee quick one. It was just to see what your thoughts were on who do you think you'll go up top with on Saturday against Kilmarnock. And that was Gordon.
Come on, you're a student of the game. You went to Ibrox last week, you were telling us.
Well, I watched him last week. Obviously, I'll be interested in the formation. They've now got so many options. They'll bring in obviously their new side. I think they'll obviously go with their new signings, Gordon, because they want them to hit the ground running.
Which ones, though? All of them?
Yeah, just most of them.
Play 14.
I think Lammers will definitely play. Lima will definitely play.
Who's Lima?
Shima, sorry.
Strong start.
I think they'll play Cantwell, obviously, off.
I think he's panicking because the cameras are on.
He's looking not himself.
Fiddling
with
that
pen. No, I'm just trying.
Danilo's the marquee signing, is he not? We've been hearing from
Danilo's,
him today.
Danilo's just in the building. Is he going to go to Rugby Park? I think he's got enough to go to Rugby Park and leave Danilo out and put him on the bench and introduce him slowly to the Scottish game. I just think that he's got that many options. As I say, he's got that bigger squad. Midfield, he's packed out with midfield players. So he's obviously, as we noticed, been very busy in the transfer market. But Michael Beale will need to get the right formation, the right team for me.
Who would you want, John?
To be honest with you, I've watched a few of the pre-season games, and I know it's a bit of a cliche. Everybody says, oh, it's a pre-season game. You know, there's four on, four off, three on. Too often, it's a bit of a mismatch. For me, to be honest with you, nothing was really exciting me with the pre-season games, to be all fairness. I don't mean to be sounding doom and gloom. I know we've got a couple of new boys in, and I know they're feeling their feet. But we were kind of lacking scoring from the forward line with the pre-season games. The goals were coming from midfield and all that. So, don't know what you thought on that as well.
I think that's a good thing, John. I think that, you know, if you're going to be a real threat in this league against Celtic. If you look at Celtic's last season, the amount of goals they got from different positions, I think that Michael Beale will be looking for that as well. Gone are the days of the Ali McCoys that scored 20, 30, 40 goals a season, whatever it may be. You need to rely on midfield players now and wide players. Celtic won the league last year because of the amount of goals they scored. And it came from different positions. And I think Michael Beale will be looking at
Rangers have been missing that, haven't they?
Yeah, Cantwell's got a big season ahead of him. I think he's got the ability to make the runs and get into the positions to go and score the goals.
John, I don't know if it becomes a saga at what point it does, but I know we were talking about José Cifuentes before the summer. I remember we spoke about it on the show, and it's now happened. It's finally over the line tonight, just before we came on air. What do you make of that one?
Well, I don't know too much about the guy, to be all fairness, but obviously they've done their homework and they've paid a bit of cash for him, so it'll be positive. As I said, I'll bounce it back to yourselves. I don't know much about him. If you know much about him, what he's kind of really all about. But
well, listen, I'll tell you what, Gordon Dalziel's Magic TV, I have no doubt, is able to provide lots of footage of the MLS because it seems to get itself everywhere else. But Although these two are great at educating the nation, every now and then we do need to just call in a real expert from elsewhere. So we've been speaking to Tom Bogart from The Athletic, who knows all about José Cifuentes. We thought we would pass that on to you. So let's hear as he gives us the lowdown on Rangers' new signing.
José Cifuentes is an all-action, box-to-box type midfielder who is really dynamic both physically and technically. His technical ability is very good. He can progress the ball very well. He's got probably underrated for his vision just because his physical gifts jump off the page. He needs to improve his final ball like any other player, but again, this is a number eight who can contribute goals. He's got a weird knack for scoring off corner kicks for somebody his size and without kind of the aerial prowess. But I think he's going to do very, very well in Scotland because the league is pretty physical like MLS is, and he excels in transition. He was viewed very highly in the United States. He was a star central midfielder on a team that won the regular season title. It's a league title in America. I know it's not quite the same as a league title in Europe just because of the way that the schedule breaks down, but they won the regular season title and he was an integral part of that. And then they won the playoff tournament, which is, again, the dumber American way of looking at things. But so he had the longevity over the 34-game regular season where he, you know, was really, really consistent from the beginning of the season to the end. And then he was, again, a key player in the playoff run in which they won the title that way as well. So, yeah, he leaves the United States with a big reputation. If his contract was longer, people were expecting, an $8 million sale to a bottom half Premier League team or a mid-table, Spanish team, something like that. So, Rangers should be good for him, and I think he'll be particularly useful in European competitions. His whole game is front foot. That's how he plays. I think that he's going to fit really well into that style. He's going to be, really useful in repressing and winning the ball in the final third or attempting to win the ball in the final third, as well as kind of duels and second balls. I think he's very, very good at that.
Mark Wilson, what do you make of what you just heard?
Going to win World Player of the Year, but the sounds of that.
Very cynical. Where did he say that? He said he has
good
to.
Everything.
No, he said he has to improve his final ball.
He does. Yeah. Well,
don't do that. Don't do that bitter thing.
I certainly am not. Listen, it sounds what Rangers need at the base of that midfield. If Michael Beale's going to play with maybe two sitters, someone a bit more commanding, a bit more physical, the attributes just described there certainly seems. What Rangers need to take them to the next level to compete with Celtic and go the full way. He's coming off the back of some success as well, which always helps when you've got a player coming in who's successful, who's got that mentality, knows how to get across the line. And he's played a lot of football. So he's coming in, not really needing to catch up. So I think the Rangers fans will be delighted with the signing. And who knows, he could go straight into the side. Daz was talking about the starting 11 at Rugby Park at the weekend. He could go straight in if everything gets cleared. And again, that's a bonus. I think when Ryan Jack is still at the club, but it's unpredictable when he's going to play because he's injury problems, I think Cifuentes might be the one to fill that gap.
Rangers fans, what do you think then? A big signing today. What do you make of it? Is it one that excites you or not? How do you see him fitting in? Is it the final piece in the jigsaw or still more to be done? We're going to hear from Brendan Rodgers soon as well. So get your calls in, please, and we'll speak to you next.
are the voice of Scottish football. Call 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon Dalziel are here. It's 0141 951 1025. Twitter at Clyde SSB. Of course, such multi-platform superstars you two now. It would be impossible for me to read out all the comments on YouTube and Facebook and whatever else you may find yourselves. Probably wouldn't want to either. Judging by some of them.
Who do you think is getting it worse?
The Dazzler is looking pensive, says Susan.
Pensive, nervy, I think.
Things that you've never been described as. When have you ever? Is pensive not someone who's like deep in thought?
The camera
something is, that you've never ever been accused of.
I'm not really used to the cameras. I'm more a radio man, if I'm honest.
I think so.
Yeah, used two guys pop up on my TV all the time. Unfortunately, it never happens for me, Mark.
This could be your big break. Sounds like he's having a go at the TV execs.
Yeah, my biggest concern is next Tuesday, what my wardrobe's going to be, because I've only got...
Are you going to write it down so you don't repeat too often?
Well, what I do in the golf...
I'm a bit worried about that.
What I do in the golf is I take a photo, and then before I play...
We've seen it.
Right.
I changed
my photograph.
Go on to Gordon Dale's Instagram if you want to see 53 pictures of him standing with his driver in his hand
with a different
golf outfit.
That's the exact same pose
every time.
Yeah. And the one thing I now do is I buy a new glove because someone picked up on that and I thought, well...
What you got on underneath there?
It's looking
good. He's wearing chinos instead. For everyone at home, the listeners, it's tracky bottoms.
I will be back to the school teacher outfit next week, guaranteed.
Anyway, we were talking before the break, Jose Cifuentes. Just wonder, Gordon, is that going to be the final piece of Rangers' jigsaw? Certainly middle to front.
Oh,
and what about overall?
Yeah, come in and certainly. I don't think Michael Beale could have any complaints. I've always said, from January, he brought in two in January, Raskin and Cantwell. And, you know, he came in for a bit of criticism, Gordon, but you've got to give managers transfer windows. Now, the one thing you can't complain about is he's had a good transfer window in the fact of numbers coming in. Yes, he's lost a few quality players, but he's got the players in that he wants. He'll probably... For me, he'll bring a different style. I think he wants to be very much on the front foot. I think it'll all be about attacking. I'll be interested to see how he does this season.
Listen, 9 players is always difficult, I think, to get that right and to get them all to jail quickly. Daz was saying earlier on, he didn't think Danilo would start the weekend because he's just new to the club. But unfortunately, when you come to the club and Morelos is away and Kent's away, two big players, when you get signed for that amount of money, is a kind of marquee signing, then you don't get much time to settle. You got to go right into the side. Cantwell and Raskin, obviously been two successes. It's whether the others can fit now. The credentials, the attributes all look good, but we've all seen it before. It's difficult to adjust coming into Rangers and Celtic. So the only time we can really judge them, no pre-season games, you know, no games that they're getting 45 minutes and then taking off, is when they go to Rugby Park on Saturday. If they start well and they look strong and powerful and blow Kilmarnock away, then we really have got something to talk about come Monday.
Absolutely. Let's hear from Brendan Rodgers, shall we? I did say he was doing his press today ahead of the weekend. It's always exciting when you get to the end of the week and you start hearing from the managers and so on as they build up to the return of the action. Here is what Brendan Rodgers had to say.
Nothing but excitement and really looking forward to it. We obviously had a really good night in James's testimonial game, and the crowd were ever so kind and gave us a great reception. But yeah, my focus is purely just preparing the team, but just driving up to the stadium and seeing all the supporters at the weekend and everyone there. And obviously the flag day, which is, you know, it's a commemoration of the great work that the players and the staff did last season. And also it's a symbol of what we're fighting for to win again. So it gives a great motivation and something for us to look forward to.
Listen, he knows what's at stake for him personally and for the club. He's been there before. He's done it before. He understands when you have that success, what it means to the supporters. He's went away, he's obviously looked in from the outside, and when the club doesn't have success, what that means for the manager who's in charge. And with some feeling still, you know, a bit disappointed in Brendan Rodgers and making that known, then he understands what's at stake for him personally if he doesn't start well, because fans can get in your back pretty quickly. But look, I've got every confidence Brendan Rodgers, being a top class manager, can come in and put his own stamp in what was already an extraordinary stride.
I'm looking forward to his starting 11 as well. As I said, I was very fortunate. I watched the game the other night there. I thought second half they had a bit more energy, a bit more drive. There's always a few players in the pre-season for me that'll play their way into a new manager's thoughts. And I've got to say, I think David Turnbull has had a terrific pre-season. I really do. Scored a goal the other night there. When Forrest and McGregor went off, took on the armband. I think that Brendan Rodgers has found a bit confidence in Turnbull, and I think it's paying off for him, because he's looking very good. Will he go with the tried and trusted at home on Saturday, or will he mix it up with a few of his new signings?
Problem is with David Turnbull, he's a fantastic player and he does well when he gets the opportunity, like Daz was saying the other night, but he's got so much quality in front of him. It seems to be an area of the pitch that whoever's the Celtic manager just keeps adding to. And that can be really frustrating for a player of Turnbull's quality, who scores goals, who contributes, but just doesn't seem to do enough to get into the forefront of the manager's mind.
What was the phrase we always heard last season? Ange ball, though. Was this just a suitability issue, rather than anything?
Yeah, maybe.
What are you thinking of Burnaby just now, Mark?
How desperate is he for this to come true? long listeners of the show will know that Gordon Dalziel was trying to flog Burnaby's case all season long, and it looked like you were on to hiding to nothing. Maybe you were right all along.
Yeah, I've come back
reborn
strong
during pre-season.
I've come back strong. I keep telling you, Gordon, you've got to be patient. You've got to give players time to settle into clubs, especially the size of Rangers and Celtic. And Burnaby, as much, look, I don't fancy him to take over from Taylor just now, because Taylor's been absolutely terrific. But he's getting better.
Let's bring in Tony, who's a Celtic fan, on the line and see what he's got for us tonight. Take it away, Tony.
Actually, 2 points. It's just to see if you've got any of our evening panel, just to see if you've heard any word about the Croatian goalie. I see that Cernbaci has pulled out the thing. I know Celtic was interested in him. I've been looking at the Celtic news now, but I've not heard nothing.
I think the answer would be no. If you think, you know, Gordon Dalziel's got many talents, but I don't think he's ears to the ground on that. Can I read between the lines, Tony? Is that because you want a new goalkeeper, or what's the motivation?
Well, I like Joe Hart, but he's a bit dodgy with the body seat, especially in front of his goal. You know.
Mark, so, this keeps coming back, really. I can't shake this conversation this week, which is fine. People can phone in about what they like, within reason. What do you think?
Listen, I think it's gathering momentum a wee bit with some Celtic fans, and it was added to the other night when Seagrass started the game, and I was here. You know, I made my thoughts known that I thought Brendan Rodgers was giving Seagrass a good shot at it to see what he was like. Now, remember the first time Brendan Rodgers was here, you know, playing out through the back from the goalkeeper was so important to him. It's dangerous changing a goalkeeper who, it's my opinion, Joe Hart has done well over the couple of seasons he's been here. I think he's made some crucial stops. Yes, he's made mistakes. Playing out for the back with his feet, not his strength. I don't think anybody could say it as a strength is. So that's his downfall. But the number one job of the goalkeeper is to keep the ball at the net. We saw the problems Celtic had in the season where Barkas came in and Hazard was in and Bain had a shot, and it just seemed to be a merry-go-round. And it led to so many issues. So Celtic have got a safe pair of hands, in my opinion, Joe Hart. But of course, when you've got somebody like Seagrass, you've got to try him. In terms of bringing somebody else in, I don't know if I would go chasing that too hard.
Is Joe Hart as a fit? You say a goalie's number one job is keeping the ball out the net, which is one of these kind of phrases that we hear. I'm not saying it's not true, but you know, it's for a lot of managers, they just look for an all-round package. Is he as effective at keeping the ball out of the net as he used to be?
Not as he used to be. I mean, name any player who is he
as effective at keeping the ball out of the net as Celtic could get at the moment? Because that's the question. It's not, well, you know, we can frame it any way you want, but that has to be the...
Well, listen, there will be goalkeepers out there. Of course, some that we've never heard of. Tony's come on and mentioned the goalkeeper in Croatia that none of us would be an expert on, but it could come in.
Well, to be fair, he does have a pretty high profile.
If you take one in, you've got to get rid of one. Right, so somebody's got to drop off. You cannot, even if you're Celtic, carry what, four goalkeepers.
Yeah, but I think in Tony's call and many others who make the point, it's more theoretical rather than, you know, being accurate with how many players there are. It's just, in general, you know, fans are allowed to do that. Do you think we could get a better goalkeeper? Do you think we should have more competition? I don't think they are so worried about the number of them, because maybe it would mean try and sell Sigrist or whatever.
But listen, there's no doubt in my mind, if the question is, can Celtic get a better goalkeeper? Of course they can. Recruiting one, finding one, and then fitting them in and making sure they perform is the hard bit. I mean, Barca signed for, it was a good bit of money.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was about £5 million. Mm-hmm. So when he signs and we're on the show, we're going, well, £5 million, the recruitment must be spot on to spend that amount. And the guy couldn't have saved the ball. And that is the important
problematic
thing.
That, isn't it?
That seems to be a bit of an issue.
His gloves are brand new.
So the hard thing is getting someone reliable. Joe Hart probably isn't as effective as he was in his first season. He has made a few errors, and in pre-season, that brings it to the forefront of people's minds.
Tony, everything else looking good for you though? Are you excited about the new season?
When you tell Mark to stop swearing when he's using the word Baccarus.
I was panicking there.
So was that.
Mark had said something that I'd missed.
And, Baccarus, aye. Well, you thought about having three goalies, right? Well, Bain's had his chance, right? And this Croatian goalie got some right up when he played in the last World Cup, if it was a World Cup, but the last big tournament, right? He got some right up. Celtic were in for him. It's always Fernabashi.
Yeah, I mean, Scott Bain obviously signed a new deal, which was a surprise for some people. And then he got his chance at Easter Road at the end of last season. It was probably a night to forget. That doesn't mean it's a complete, you know, lost cause forever. But it's going to be interesting to see what Celtic. How close do you think Celtic are then, Mark, to having completed their business? Because the season starts, so you almost fall into the trap of thinking that you need everything done by now, and you would like it, but there's still 4 weeks left of the window.
I think there's still business to be done for Celtic
to bring in.
But also, well, both ways. I think they need to get some out the door as well. It's a big squad, but I think Brendan Rodgers will still want to add to it. Now, what's your priority positions? Maybe goalkeeper is up there for him. We saw how important it was for him before. I don't know. You'd have to ask the manager himself. Is he happy with Kyogo and O through the middle, and sometimes Maeda? Maybe sometimes you need three, you know, in that position. And your wide men, well, there's plenty of midfield. Your wide men, he's added to it, but are any of those going to fill the boots of Jota? Well, again, only the manager will know that.
I can't see Celtic bringing more players.
None?
No. I don't. Because unless you offload a few, because you look at James Forrest's testimonial, and he changed the team. Now, you had 20 outfield players that are capable of playing in Celtic's first team. You're not looking at young boys coming in that he's given an opportunity because it was a testimonial. It was experienced players that have won trophies, guys that have cost money. So sometimes you can bring in too many. If he offloads a few, obviously gives them a bit of space. Of course it does. But right now, as the squad stands, there's not many I think he needs. And Mark is back to the goalkeeper. I think Joe Hart's good enough to play next season. No problems at all.
Thank you very much to Tony on the line. Let me tell you about this before we go any further.
Oh, you're kidding me on.
Oh, thank you.
Cash register. Clyde
won. Yes, Kenzie won over £50,000.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
Did you hear?
Incredible.
She was having a coffee.
Lucky oil.
In Starbucks when the luck changed big time. Now, it was your chance to win £55,555. Quite easy to remember tomorrow when we make the next call. Enter now. Text YES to 61025. That's YES to 61025. If you get the call from us after 3 p.m. on Friday, tomorrow, the 4th of August, answer within five rings. Make sure you know the correct cash register amount. The texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. Online entries £2 or call 0330 880 4523, and the calls are charged at the standard rate as well. Over 18s only. All the rules for this Hits Radio Network Scotland competition are on our website. So to be in with the chance, text YES to 61025. £55,555. Good luck.
This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Thursday night, it means only one thing, or two things really. Mark Wilson and Gordon Dalziel will be here to talk you through the day's football stories, look ahead to the weekend, and generally keep you company with their warmth and enthusiasm for the beautiful game.
Yeah, like any secret, he's moaning
Hold on a minute. What's up? A secret. He's already to tell everybody. I don't know what to do with my hands.
Are you struggling with this new streaming?
I'm struggling with this mic
by your side,
being in front.
Just sit.
And I'm quite hit my knees off the desk, if you know what I mean.
Keeps touching my foot as well.
I've never touched your foot.
You two playing footsie under that desk. That's the
worst lie I've heard so far.
You kicked me. I didn't touch your foot.
I have noticed, because you're paying that pen an awful lot of attention for a man who I've never seen write anything down in the last 6 years.
I don't, but I've been watching a lot of TV
newsreaders and stuff to try.
Yeah, and you've got to, like Sky Sports, when you get into Sky Sports, they teach you, you've got to make hands.
I've never shuffled
your papers like a newsreader. Let's see how you do it.
No, I
doesn't
like
watch the news.
I'm more like my hand movement. My hand movement.
Go for that. Listen, the cameras are on. It's not. Yeah. It's people are meant to see you in your natural
very
habitat.
Very rigid today. Yeah. Very
panic.
Rigid.
The panicking is not sitting.
You've also spiked that hair up.
Oh yeah, I've spiked that one up.
Remarkably.
I went in today, got a little bit more off.
Shockwaves on that, eh?
A little bit more off. Is it looking okay?
It's looking whiter.
Jaggy.
The lad gives the hairspray. Somebody actually, I was at a golf thing on Saturday. I was walking by and he went, "Oh, here comes Santa Claus."
Did you go for your sunbed that you promised him?
No, I've not. I've not been well enough to go for a sunbed, but I'm okay.
You don't want to get caught short in the sunbed.
I sprayed it. Please clean after.
I think we need to move on. People are eating their dinner, bearing in mind. Jimmy is a Rangers fan. He's in Cambuslang. How's it going, Jimmy?
I'm doing not so bad, my man.
Good. What's your point tonight?
Well, I had one of your panels saying Brendan Rodgers was a brilliant manager. Now, he walked through in Celtic when they were gone for 10 in a row. Mm-hmm. He goes down to Leicester. They get relegated. They get sacked. And these managers, they just treat the fans with contempt. They really do. It's they get people into foreign countries and they come in and everything like that. And the next minute, they walk out the door. And then a new manager might come in and don't like them. But the fact that he's, I didn't see people queuing up for him once when they get sacked for Leicester. There was lots of teams looking for managers, but not one come near him. And next minute he's grovelling back up to Celtic. Oh, I quite agree. The fans should be annoyed with that. I don't know about the panel.
So ultimately, Jimmy, you're a Rangers fan, but you don't think Brendan Rodgers is a good manager. You think he's, you know, think he's failed down south. Is that the gist?
The panel's comment that it was a brilliant manager. Okay, it was great up here, done fabulous for Celtic, but he jumped ship, was doing there and then gets sacked. How does I get a great manager?
Listen, well, everybody's entitled to their opinion, I guess. Yeah. The, my problem's always been, Mark, every manager gets sacked now, don't they? So, to sort of use that as your barometer as to whether someone's good or not.
No one would be good.
Difficult, isn't
no
it?
No one would be good. I mean, pick
Pep
one.
And Jurgen Klopp,
well,
maybe.
Maybe them, Sir Alex Ferguson in his time, but every other manager gets sacked. You can only judge Brendan Rodgers and what he's achieved. Now, remember before he even arrived at Celtic, when he went into Liverpool and how close he got them to the league, and people say, oh, he didn't win it, but he got them moving in the right direction. He then came to Celtic. He then came to Celtic and won everything. Now, he went down to Leicester and won an FA Cup. I think two top five finishes, which is sensational for Leicester. I know they won the league. They're never, ever going to do that again. So he got them fifth in a league that's the most competitive, richest league in the world. And then, of course, things went... Well, he didn't get relegated. He got sacked before they got relegated. I take your point, he got sacked. But just for facts, he didn't get relegated. So he's now came to Celtic as an outstanding manager with a great record up here. And when you say, you know, nobody wanted to touch him, did Brendan Rodgers not come out and say that there was another Premier League club that he'd spoke to and it wasn't right for him? So... Jimmy, I get you're a Rangers fan and you want
Jimmy's got to you the way.
I'm slagging. I can slag Gerrard as well because he done it. He walked to him and didn't ask Fuller and get sacked. So many, don't bring the Rangers thing into it.
But they all get sacked. But, well, the difference is that Brendan Rodgers has been hugely successful here in Scotland. So he is an outstanding manager.
10 in a row was shameful. And I can see why the Celtic supporters are angry about that.
He wasn't here. He left before that.
Jimmy,
what are you shouting at me
for? He left in the middle of the season when they could have won the league and get them 10 in a row.
Well, they did win the league when Brendan Rodgers left, Neil Lennon came in. They did win the league, so he put them in a good position. What do you want him to do? Stay forever?
I think Jimmy's got to you.
He's got under your skin. Oh, week Jimmy's one of the season,
keep
Jimmy.
It going,
you've got,
Jimmy.
Jimmy, you've got
I'm
him
enjoying
on toast.
This.
You have got him on toast, Jimmy. It does feel a bit bizarre to sort of argue Brendan Rodgers' CV, Gordon. Because we're going to go forward and then we'll find out. And you know what? See if Brendan Rodgers flops this season, Jimmy can come back on at the end and say, I told you he wasn't a good manager. I think we just probably need a little bit. We just need to fill in that gap a bit between being sacked at Leicester and what happened before. Let's let John and Knightswood do it, because I guess John's not happy with what he's heard. John?
No, I'm actually in tears of laughter at that guy. Brendan Rodgers is the most successful British manager in the last 10 years in Scotland and in England. There's no British manager won as much as she has in England in the last 10 years, and the same goes for up in Scotland. So I don't know what planet that boy comes from, but I think you should go back here, because it must be playing Looney Tunes all the time.
And now this is the beauty of the show. Now I'm racking my brains trying to find someone who might be the most successful UK manager. I've got no intention of doing down Brendan Rodgers. I guess he would be up there. UK managers. Moyes won some silverware last year.
Look, everybody can throw the Brendan Rodgers who gets sacked at Leicester. He didn't get sacked. He left, and obviously,
well,
look, I think it was on the cards for a long while. Leicester happened to get relegated.
Did he leave Brecon?
He got thrown out of Brecon. He's never been in Brecon again. But Brendan Rodgers, you can't argue his record. When Celtic were looking for a manager and Brendan Rodgers was available and the rumours were going about that he was going to come back to Celtic, I know Celtic fans, quite a lot of them, were not happy because of the situation when he left. But to bring a manager back with the experience, the knowledge, the clubs he's managed, success he's had, not even in Scotland, as Mark quite rightly pointed out, he was successful up to a point with Leicester, winning the cup, getting the top five, top six finishes in a really hard, hard league. So he brings more experience into that as well. And sometimes as a manager, getting removed from your job, let us say, I think that gives you the hunger again to go and show that, look, that was a blip. I am a very good manager and very good coach. So I think Brendan Rodgers quite rightly come out so far this season and said, look, I need to prove myself again. So he's got that hunger, he's got that fire in his belly again. And I think that can only be good for Celtic.
I think maybe it's worth bearing in mind, everything's relative as well, because we can argue about who is the most successful UK manager of the past 10 years. You can frame it in different ways, but surely the real question is, could Celtic have attracted a better manager? That's the relevant bit. Is he as good as Celtic could have got? And I think that's probably the bit that people say yes to, isn't it?
I think it is as good as Celtic
I don't think anyone here is saying Brendan Rodgers, you know, could have picked any job in Europe and he chose Celtic. That's not the point.
Yeah. I think Celtic moved swiftly. I think they would have known Brendan Rodgers would have been their primary target. They would have had others, no doubt, that they would have spoke to. But as soon as they started pursuing Brendan Rodgers, then, you know, it was the number one choice and they got it over the line. That's why you've got to give great credit to the Celtic board and Dermot Desmond for getting a job done quickly, because there's a lot can go wrong. We all know, Gordon, when you go on the continent for a manager who's up and coming or been someone's number two and it looks attractive at the time, it might not work out that way. At least with Brendan Rodgers, you know the pedigree you're getting when you bring up with the club.
I love that, because this is the beauty of the show. Always has been, whether it's on streaming services or not. If you might just tuned in and saying, why are they arguing about who the best UK manager of the last 10 years is? That's the beauty of it. I take it, John, you're looking forward to the new season with the most successful UK manager of the last 10 years at the helm.
Oh, definitely. And he'll probably win another 7 in a row, then maybe depart for Pastures New. And I'm quite happy with that.
Good. Good to see no one's getting carried away. Seven in a row. These guys have got enough. These guys have got enough trouble predicting who's going to win one league. John's got the next seven.
Seven gone.
Right. I feel like we're really back. You know what? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. It was all a bit gentle. It was all a bit friendly.
And then Jimmy comes
back.
On.
Now we're back.
We're back
with a bang.
Because his face went scarlet.
Oh, by the way, Jimmy got to you something terrible.
Jimmy did. You were starting to nod your head quickly, Jimmy. That's when I know you're going. I've seen the signs.
Anyway, thank you, Jimmy. You got Mark Wilson going, and that is good enough for me. Thank you to John as well for the counterpoint, and we are up and running for the new season, no doubt about it. And I've really, really, all summer, it's all I could think about. What will the first Thursday night Beat the Pundit be like of the new season? Let's find out.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun. For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
There's been some serious hype about this. Because you and Beat the Pundit have had a, let me think of an appropriate phrase, a troubled relationship.
You're talking
like,
about
like
me
many here, of your relationships. Troubled. You and Beat the Pundit over the years.
I can't argue
it's,
with
it's
that.
It's love hate. Yeah. Has its ups and its downs. Mm-hmm. And the downs tend to be quite spectacular.
Downs hurt.
So you think of all the classics over the years, mm-hmm. the United States of Arab,
Argentina.
Bevis Mugabe representing Argentina, and the list goes
on. I'm still
on.
Hopeful for all that.
And then you go out the next day to popular supermarkets or golf courses and people remind you about it for months on end. Just think what that's going to be like with that camera right in your face as you come up with some of these answers.
Yeah.
How does that make you feel?
I don't fear it. I embrace it. I'm looking forward to it. And I feel that this could be a good season for me.
Well, let's find out. 01419511025. Your chance to Beat the Pundit is next. Give us a call. The lines close at 7.
please.
Tackle the headlines. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Dalziel and Mark Wilson are here. I just spend the full news now reading the outstanding feedback that you two get on the live stream. So hopefully you're enjoying it if you're just listening as you normally do. Brilliant to still have you this season as well. We're building up to the return of the Premiership, so please, and the other leagues of course, so please do get in touch, whether it is those games, whether it's new signings, something else altogether. Please get in touch. We've heard from Brendan Rodgers. We've heard from an MLS expert on Jose Cifuentes, who Rangers have signed this evening. So if you want to add to those topics, feel free. If you want to move it on, you can do. But let's do this first.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Ah, Beat the Pundit time. The first Thursday night Beat the Pundit of the new season is always a highlight of my calendar year, but this could take it to new levels. The fact that this
is he played yet?
Is on
no,
screen.
Hugh
no,
played
Hugh
the other
played
night.
On Tuesday and lost.
How did they go?
Hugh lost.
Hugh first lost in my place.
Simon yeah. Donnelly won last night and Kenny Miller won on Monday.
So Hugh's the only one that's let us down so far. Yeah.
How are you feeling about it generally?
I'm fine.
Honestly?
Yeah.
See anyone that says they're fine? Not fine.
It's like doing his best Ross from Friends there.
I'm fine. I'm fine.
I don't think I've got the best preparation this week, but in general, I'm very confident.
It's hard to study on the pan, isn't it?
I really. Should have been reading the newspaper. It's one of your favourite hobbies.
With the light out.
Anyway, let's meet tonight's contestant, who is Alan in Blantyre, I believe. How's it going, Alan?
I'm all right, Gordon. How are you, pal?
Yeah, all good here. Have you ever played before?
I've played once, maybe about a season and a half ago.
Right.
Possibly.
How did it go?
Mr. Wilson beat me 6-5.
Oh.
That sounds respectable,
what
Adam.
What a game.
When did you ever get six?
I was just mouthing to Daz there. He sounds good.
And when did you ever get six?
He's obviously proved he is good, but it's not good enough.
Not sure.
So that was a little cheers, pal.
Throwing out nicknames, are you old pals?
Chums.
You too. Willow. It's Willow, is it?
More than welcome to call me Willow.
No, listen, to be fair, when I had my season ticket, I used to shout a lot worse.
No, I'll bet. Like I will bet. Okay, let's see how we go then. What we're going to do is toss the coin. Heads, it's Mark Wilson. Tails, it's Gordon Dalziel. That's the way it works now.
Right, that's fine. It's different.
New studio.
It's different, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a bit different. How long into the season before I make a mess of the toss?
I don't think so.
It gets picked up on
camera. You've been doing okay with that?
Magnificent. Look at that. Self-praise is no praise. It's Tails, and it genuinely is.
Who is
Tails? You.
Your Tails. Oh, is it me? Okay.
Okay, what we'll do here is give he's absolutely gone.
Jeez, please.
Let's give Gordon Dalziel some greatest hits.
Can I just point out, right, I've actually stuck my TV off now because I don't want to see what he's up to while I'm trying to answer these questions.
Very good, very, very good idea. Because also the delay would probably throw you off. And anyway, so let's give Gordon Dalziel some greatest hits radio in his ear nice and loud so that he can't hear us.
Thank you.
Can you still hear me, Gordon Dalziel? What are you shaking your head at?
It's the women doing the intro and
the music's not started yet.
That's very honest of you. Do you want me to pad?
What's
for a little
pad
bit?
Mean?
It means if I keep talking, then eventually the music will start
right,
and you won't
on.
Be able to
I think
hear
I'm getting something, it's building up, but I'm just hearing talking. Well, I can obviously hear you.
Do you know what it might be? One of your ears is out of your headphones.
I know, but I can still hear you.
Right, tuck that lug back in.
What are you saying?
There we go, we're good to go. Right, Alan, are you ready?
I'm very good.
30 seconds on the clock and your time starts now. In what year did Rangers last win the League Cup?
The League Cup was 2012.
Who did Effie Ambrose join on loan whilst at Celtic?
Hibernian.
How many teams are in the Scottish Lowland League?
10.
True or false, Riyad Mahrez was once on trial at St Mirren?
True.
Who was Rangers' record transfer fee paid in November 2000?
Torrey and Duflo.
Riley Harbottle has signed for Hibs from which club?
Pass.
What country are Hibs Euro Conference opponents Interclub de Escaldes from?
Andorra.
Okay, let's bring Gordon Dalziel back.
This is going to be good.
Can you hear us?
Yeah.
This will be good.
Oh, you can
do
see
you realise when you're dancing away to Greatest Hits Radio, people can see you.
I can only apologise.
Nobody needs to see you dancing. Are you ready?
Right.
Your first Beat the Pundit of the new season.
Yeah, let's go.
Streamed in glorious high definition. Are you ready?
Ready.
Your time starts now. In what year did Rangers last win the League Cup?
2018.
Who did Effie Ambrose join on loan whilst at Celtic?
Hibs.
How many teams are in the Scottish Lowland League?
12.
True or false, Riyad Mahrez was once on trial at St Mirren?
True.
Who was Rangers' record transfer fee paid in November 2000?
Oh, pass.
Riley Harbottle has signed for Hibs from which club?
Pass.
And what country are Hibs Euro Conference opponents Andorra. Interclub de Escaldes from? Okay. What do you think, Alan?
I think he might be lucky to sneak a tiebreak, yeah.
Listen to you, Alan.
Shots fired.
Stick your TV on and have
a
look at
that. Alan's wee? Alan might be 6'5".
Well, right enough, I don't exactly. know that, yeah.
Yeah, Gordon, I'm 5'6", to be fair.
It's wee Alan. Even to me, which is saying something. I mean, Alan's got a fan club.
A couple of hard ones on there for my debut.
Sean tonight. Tweeted straight away to say, that's my wee pal, Alan, on Beat the Pundit. He's a massive Harry Potter fan, apparently, Alan.
Listen, I'm really not.
I'm worried about what sort of private joke we've just stumbled upon.
Don't you
I
move
on.
That, Gordon, don't you
will we move
that?
On?
I like Harry Potter. Yeah. I was ready to chat.
Come on, I want to hear how the result goes my first night.
You were hopeless at the first one. And what year did Rangers last win the League Cup? It was 2011. I felt for Alan. He was close, but not close enough.
I didn't know.
That was you may as well guess.
I'm devastated.
Brendan Rodgers.
I know. I forgot that.
Effie Ambrose joined Hibs on loan whilst at Celtic.
Good shout, that.
Yeah, I was going to go Livingston.
Alan
but I
got it as well though.
Oh, well done,
one
Alan.
There are 18 teams in the Lowland League.
Did Alan get that?
He didn't. So it's still 1-1. Riyad Mahrez was once on trial at St Mirren. Is this producer John, new producer for the new season? Do you think he's flexing his muscles, sticking in a wee true or false? We don't usually do
that. Yeah, I like that. But it was a nice 100%
when
true.
When I read it, it is true. Did he not borrow a bike? And
Did Alan get that as well?
Whatever happened to him anyway. Yeah, Alan got that. So 2-2. Rangers record transfer fee.
How did you not get this one?
Paid November 2000.
You got about it. You were
Tory Andrew Flo.
Tory Andrew Flo.
He played against us in the cup final. 12 million.
Yeah. Did he score?
Yeah, he did. That's why I tried to forget.
Honestly, the tea lady scored that day.
Well, don't tell me wee Alan got that.
Of course he did.
Everybody
the full watching nation got that. So Alan is in front. Riley Harbottle, what a name, has signed for Hibs from Nottingham Forest. None of you got it.
Oh, no chance.
And Interclub de Escaldes, though, are from Andorra, Gordon Dalziel.
So you got that?
Alan got it as well. You're beat.
No!
You're beat. Well done, Alan.
The first one of the season.
That's
a nice
Gordon,
that's the first of many, son.
Right, Alan.
Willow and son, he's got you two.
The ball's bigger than you, off you go.
Brilliant.
He's done you.
Four, was that a 4-3 in the end, I think? Or a 3-2?
Andrew.
4-3. He won it by one, so. Anyway, well done. Do you know what I think we're going to, I think we should introduce for this season?
I'm disappointed with that.
Sign the ball live on the stream so people get to see.
Yeah.
Are you okay? You know where you are.
I didn't know
you
were still there.
I was going to introduce a height restriction.
Fade him down. I used to have the power to do that in the old studio.
Keep going, Alan. What are you up to tonight?
Anyway.
I'll be quiet one.
I keep thinking he's gone.
What are you having for your dinner?
Oh, I've had that.
Nice. Oh, brilliant, Alan. Oh, I should have went to a tiebreaker there.
Hopeless from you.
I thought one or two was quite hard.
Small one, Alan, you staying on the full night with us?
Yeah.
If you want, I.
Right, there we are. I think he is gone. I'm fully hopeful that he's gone. Anyway, you can call us on the usual number. You can tweet us at Clyde SSB. We are looking at Rangers' new signing, Jose Cifuentes. We're hearing from Brendan Rodgers earlier in the show. Massive night for Hibs. Massive, doesn't even cover it if it goes wrong. So we'll look at that in the not too distant future. Motherwell have been making signings today as well. A few other teams doing some business. I saw St Johnstone bolster their defensive options. So there is a lot happening out there. Please do get in touch. In fact, let's take, whilst we line up another caller, let's take a look at that Hibs game tonight, because Lee Johnson's been bullish and confident and hopeful, and of course that may well be the case. In fact, do you expect it to? Will they overturn this tonight?
They need to, I think.
Well, yeah.
You know, it'd be a disaster of a result. I think they will, Gordon. I really do. I think if they can get an early goal, it will certainly lift the crowd, because if they go along there and they don't start the front foot, they don't get that early goal. We've all been there before. The crowd gets anxious. It transfers onto the field. The players start to get anxious. All of a sudden, you could find yourself in a bad night. But I truly expect after last week, with the shock and the criticism, I watched some of the supporters who made the journey. You know, they made their feelings to the players and the management staff. So I think they owe them one. I think they'll go off to a good start tonight and win that.
Alan and Blantyre is phoning. He's phoning back in for some for some unknown reason. He was not happy with his 45 minutes of fame. He's actually trying to phone
he's
back in.
A good point.
What's going on?
He's got me to say the guy. He's terrific.
Incredible. To Hibs.
Listen, to Hibs. Look, I fully expect him to get the job done, and we had quite a bit to spare. There's no doubt it was one of the biggest shocks that we've seen in a long time. It happens too often, actually, to Scottish clubs. David Marshall had a howler. I don't expect him to do that again. No doubt a terrible start, but the good thing about these two-legged affairs and the second leg being at home is you get the chance to redeem it yourself.
I mean, Lee Johnson was so intent on hammering home the message that it was half-time in the tie yesterday that he even said, I mean, you don't usually do interviews at half-time in a game. I know what he, but yeah. I was going to say I know what he means. I'm not sure that I do, because two-legged football's been around for a while. Not two-legged football, two-legged ties. You always have to react to the first game, and if it doesn't go well, you need to take it on the chin until you get the chance to make up for it the next week.
I think that was the problem with the Hibs fans, that the post-match comments didn't reflect their views. He sort of played it down. Now, on one hand, he was probably trying to keep a lid on it with the players. I suspect behind closed doors he may have had a different message for his actual players, but he was trying to play it down. Probably reflecting on it, he may have thought, I should have went a wee bit harder. But
no, then
he spoke yesterday. So, like, his team has to do the talking
tonight. You know,
and
he said all these Andorran football experts that have come out the woodwork, you know, I told you it would be tough over there. This will be totally different. It's a bigger pitch. So here's one for you. David Marshall.
Yeah.
To some people, finished the season poorly. Real howler last week. Stripped of the captaincy during the summer.
Paul Hanlon now.
Two new goalkeepers signed. Would you drop him for tonight?
It's a tough one, because I think that...
No, don't sit in the fence. I want some direct.
Yeah, I probably would.
Yeah?
I agree with what you said. Not just... I wouldn't drop him one howler, because every goalkeeper will make a howler in their career. There's no doubt. David Marshall being a terrific goalkeeper. What you said there about his finish of the season, I didn't think he finished the season particularly well, Gordon. I would make the change if I brought in two new goalkeepers, because you've got to give them opportunity.
Team was named about an hour ago. David Marshall starts in goal. And
it's Gordon. It's two new.
Yeah, I can see the way he was building that up.
Ah, I love that one. And the new captain, Paul Hanlon, plays Will Fish, back for a second loan spell from Man United. Didn't play last week. He goes in as well. He's taken Ryan Portis as number five. A bit of expectation on him. Ilya Ewan is in there. Jake Doyle-Hayes, Joe Newell, Lewis Stevenson, Christian Doige, Del Ferrier, and Josh Campbell. And the one I've saved until last, because it's definitely the most interesting, 10 months out. Didn't feature last week. Came back in a friendly at the weekend. And to save the day, Martin Boyle.
Well, he's such a huge player, such a terrific talent, makes huge impacts in the game when he plays, when he's fit, and he's had such an unlucky time of it. Hibs need him to be back firing on all cylinders, not just tonight, but for the rest of the season. When you take Nesbitt out of that team, I know they've signed Venti, but Nesbitt was a huge part of that side. They need Boyle to come back and be the main man alongside Venti this season.
Yeah, Dylan Venti signed for a lot of money by all accounts. We're talking Hibs record transfer, or I think in that neck of the woods, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of pounds, maybe talking around seven. And not able to play, not registered in time. But Martin Boyle back, Gordon.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant for the lad as well. I think he's a big player, gives them bags of pace, gives them goals as well, and they're going to certainly need that. I think that's a great boost for Lee Johnston Hibs.
Okay, 01419511025. Let's bring in Stephen, who's a Motherwell fan on the line. How's it going, Stephen?
Hi guys, could I just say I'm absolutely loving the new format. It was nice to see Mark Wilson crumble under pressure for Jimmy for Campbell's flank. That was a stark reminder to how the end of his career went. So
it crumbled under a few wingers, Stephen.
Yeah, that is true. What was the caller's name again?
Jimmy
just did to you on the radio what Daniel Kuzan did to you down that right hand side or left hand side from your perspective.
Yeah, it's not been a good start to the season. Right, Stephen, what's your point? Never mind having a go at me.
No, my point is I was sitting here on Wednesday just worried with the season, looking forward the fact that we didn't have a recognised goal scorer, but I'm excited with the signing that we've made today.
Sorry, Stephen, to interrupt you. Just quickly, because it's breaking news and it really feeds into something I've just said. So timing's everything in this business. David Marshall's in I'm not laughing because I wish him well, but you'll get, if you listen to the last 5 minutes, he's been injured in the warm-up, genuinely.
I told you.
But hold on, we need to be clear. We're not laughing at David Marshall's misfortune. David is a great get well soon. But genuinely, he's been injured in the warm-up and has been replaced by Jojo Wallacott.
That's a man. Incredible. Stuff.
Yeah,
he can see the future
of events. Wow,
that's
he's
incredible.
A visionary.
Sorry, Stephen. So the new signing for Motherwell today—that's what you were on about, yeah?
Yeah, and listen, I'm in a wheelchair, and a YouTube video could probably make me look like the same boat. But there's certain attributes that I look for in a cycle when I watch these videos, and he's really direct when he runs. He seems quite physical, which I think you need for this league, and look. I watch videos of the new signing we make, and the only other player that I kind of got the impression that he'd be good to Kevin Van Veen gave me the same feeling. So I'm excited. He's a Danish under 21 international. And listen, we're going to be tough to beat under Kettlewell, so I don't think we'll concede many goals.
See, this is life this season. Stephen's Usain Bolt wheelchair joke in the past. Our facial expressions don't matter. Now everyone can see them.
I've got to say, I feel sorry for who's going to be up front for Motherwell. Big boots to fill. Van Veen has got to be a massive...
Size 11.
Yeah, massive. You've got to say the amount of goals. That's what most of their success was built on, because it's all about putting the ball in the back of the net. But, you know, they needed players in, Gordon. Of course they did. Abika got... a couple of goals in the...
Injured at the weekend, yeah. Connor Wilkinson played.
Yeah.
He got a bad head knock, actually, but I think he's fine for the weekend. But Mark, there was then... they needed it. As Gordon says, it's... What's Hugh Keevan's most hated word on the show? Narrative. Yep. It's just set. It's going to be there all season. The Kevin Van Veen factor. You just don't forget about a guy like that that quickly. Stuart Kettlewell spoke today, giving Theo Bear a bit of backing because he scored one goal for St Johnstone last season. Motherwell have signed him, but Stuart Kettlewell saying, look, I've seen something in him I think that can work, so have my staff. And now, as Stephen quite rightly points out tonight, a different type of signing, if you like. You know, our clubs, our smaller clubs, sometimes have got a couple of options. You can do that. You can go to a big club and look for a loan player. You can get the so-called kind of journeyman, maybe, or, you know, go League One, League Two in England. That's where Motherwell and Kilmarnock and St Mirren's will recruit. So this one from Arsenal, a young player, and it'll be very interesting to see how that pans
out. Well, decent record, scoring record down there, under 21 side for Arsenal. So, obviously Motherwell needs someone to fill the boots, like you're saying, of Van Veen, and it may not be one man, it may be a collective effort. That's why Bear coming in, quite a curious one. Sure, Kettlewell obviously sees something in him, and we were chatting the other night, Keltwell's got a reputation of developing young players and just bringing something out in them. So, you know, a lot of them combined may step up and do the job Van Veen had. And this kid's just the latest one. It's always interesting when you see a kid coming up from such an elite academy, if they can cut it here.
Because there's so many. My impression's always been, Stephen, that these clubs have got so many players that it, that there's still a degree of talent within there. You look at some that have come up recently, Leighton Clarkson was at Liverpool.
What about
brilliant,
Dylan,
you know,
Levitt
really good
as well.
And guys like that. Yeah. Then in the past there have been guys, with no disrespect to them, I won't even name them, you think, how have they been at the elite club?
Do you know that I think the difference now is they're very well coached now, well drilled.
But that's what I mean, they're bound to be.
Technically, I think they're very good. It's just, can they handle the physical side of the Scottish game, the pace of it.
Stephen, it all starts this week. So overall, what are your thoughts? Where are your confidence levels at from a Motherwell perspective?
Well, before the cup, the forward that we brought us in, I had this kind of a wee bit of a dogfight. But listen, if Mika can come in and get some goals, I'm really excited about a midfield. I think that's got goals in it, and Millen and Slattery as well, and Spittle. So I think we can maybe hopefully push for top six. I think that's always the aim. But we need to get off to a good start on Saturday. And listen, it's a wonderful game for both sides up at Dundee.
Absolutely. Thank you, Stephen. Nice to hear from you. Hopefully we'll do it again soon. I'm looking forward to this. It is that time of the night. Let's do it.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Pipelining with Pipeline Energy Solutions.
All this week on Clyde One Super Scoreboard, we're teaming up with our mates at Pipeline Energy Solutions, and every night giving you the chance to win £250 in cash. All you need to do is play our game Pipelining, and it has been magnificent. We discovered on Monday that Kenny Miller, do you hear this, Gordon Dalziel, was a three-time junior bowls champion when he was younger.
Yeah, that's
Tuesday
impressive.
Night, we found out that Leonardo DiCaprio over here sunk his boat on Long Island.
Yeah, I knew.
Did you know that
this man had a boat?
Did you know he sunk it though?
Yeah, I'm not surprised at that. He sunk most teams he was out managing them.
And last night, Marvin Bartley the beacon ship, as they call it. And last night, Marvin Bartley tried to convince us that he once applied and got to the latter stages for Big Brother. But that was indeed his lie. Right. So anyway, tonight is going to be potentially disastrous, potentially award-winning. This guy, Gordon Dalziel, camera, zoom in nice and tight. He lies so much,
these
he doesn't even
lies.
Know when he's telling the truth. So he's in the hot seat tonight. You have to give us a call before the end of this break and establish which is Gordon's lie and which is his truth. 01419511025 before the end of this next break. So go on, in no particular order. I can't even trust you to do this accurately, but we'll try.
Do you want to just now?
Give us your two statements.
Okay. My first one is, obviously they're all based in Manchester as a legend at Man City. When I'm down there, my biggest ambition was to go to Coronation Street, to see around Coronation Street.
Believable.
I had a pint of beer in the Rovers' return, right? And the most popular thing I was very privileged to was Betty's Hot Pot.
You actually got to
eat Betty's Hot Pot.
Right, okay, yeah. What's your next one? I wish you'd phrased it differently.
my second one, a big snooker fan. I get invited to practice with Alex Higgins, and I drove him home when he beat Steve Davis, United Kingdom, at the Guildhall in Preston after coming back from 7-0 down.
Wow. Two very different statements. Did Gordon Dalziel eat Betty's Hot Pot, or did he drive Alex Higgins home? Oh, we're going to get taken off.
I know the one I hope to.
01419511025. Lines close at the end of this break.
taking your calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Dalziel and Mark Wilson are here, and a great start, the exact start that Hibs needed. Martin Boyle, we said, what a difference this guy could make. Returning 10 minutes on the clock, he has scored. Hibs actually didn't start great, and I wonder if the fans were already fearing the worst. But Martin Boyle has scored. One up, two all on aggregate. Famous last words. Surely they go on and progress from here.
Yeah, I think they've got the boost with Boyle being back, and obviously showing how important a player he is for the club. Yeah, they've got the early goal, Gordon. That's what they needed to settle the nerves. I think they'll go on and win this comfortably.
Yeah,
yeah, I have to agree. Yeah, it's the ideal start. You know, backs up what Lee Johnson was saying, that the home leg would be totally different, and it just shows you how important a player Boyle is. I think they'll go on and win this well out to spare.
Plenty of time left here till 8 o'clock. Get your calls in. We're talking earlier in the show, Jose Cifuentes signing. We're talking, well, we heard from Brendan Rodgers and his press duties today. He says the mentality is to just go and win the league. It's not about retaining it or defending it. That's not the mindset. And actually, Rangers fans, I think you'll be interested in this. Some very interesting comments about Graeme Souness as to why he did not end up back at the club in any sort of role this summer. So we'll play them next, but let's do this first.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Pipelining with Pipeline Energy Solutions.
I need to thank Pipeline Energy Solutions for teaming up with us for the £250 cash that we've been giving away every night this week. I'll tell you what, at this time of the evening, regular listeners will know it's usually when we do the full-time teaser. We will bring that back next week, so please do submit your questions. So we've got loads to work through as the season progresses. But Pipeline, and even the name, great, terrific, nice pun there. And it basically, each pundit, it's like, would I lie to you? They give us two statements. You have to decide which one is the truth, which one is a lie. And if you get it right, you win £250. So tonight it was Gordon Dalziel's turn. Before the break, he told us that he once ate Betty's Hot Pot at Coronation Street, and that he also turned chauffeur for Alex Higgins and drove him away from one of the most famous matches in snooker history, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Both quite remarkable. What did Betty's hot pot taste like?
Very good. Everybody, the secret was the recipe. The one thing I always wanted to do was, and this is true, that actually,
how would you describe the flavour?
A bit of, it's lamb, believe it, with the potatoes and everything cooked.
Right.
Cooked 30 minutes in oven, Worcester sauce.
You were watching our cooking.
How did this work? Well, because if you go on like a tour of the studio, you're not getting the hot pot.
No,
you
know, I went down with a set.
I've been in the Rover's Return, no, Gordon.
Yeah,
it's a set. Hot food.
It's a set.
And what you do is you get real beer, and that's the one thing. And up until a certain point, right? And I was sitting with the Duckworths and Curly Watts, and I remember Curly,
because he was a big City fan.
He emptied the bins.
He was a City fan, though, wasn't he? The guy who played him.
Yeah,
sure he is.
A massive City fan.
That is making sense now.
Jack and Vera were there.
Right, and the second,
I went down with some City players.
Let me just test you quickly in the second. How did you become chauffeur for Alex Higgins on that day of all days?
I was in the hotel. I just arrived at Manchester at that time, and a guy called Chubby Chandler, who was a professional golfer. He's now a massive sport agent to the likes of
Lee Westwood.
That's
the most made up name I've ever heard.
And
he's a real person.
And he called me up and he says, "Look, are you bored tonight?" He says, "I'm going round to see Alex practice before we go."
Okay, right. Well, let's see. Both outrageous. Both probably lies. Let's be honest. John is in Kilsyth. How's it going, John?
Hi, Gordon. How you doing? I'm all right.
Thank you for playing Pipeline tonight. Which one of those is true and which one is a lie?
I think the snooker one's true, because I'm sure I've heard Gordon mention it on the before. He's already said the story, so a bit of advice, Gordon. Well, do something you've already spoke about.
I know, but what I'm
that's not really how the competition meant to work.
But what I'm going to say, I lied at that time.
That's outstanding. Only you could, and is that the case?
The snooker one is true. I've never ever said that I drove Higgins home from the
girl. You must
talk.
Have, because John's
I think I've said
that you were friends with him.
snooker with
how
Alex
good is
Chicken.
That? This guy doesn't even know what stories he's told, and he's broken the full competition.
Do you know something? I thought the Rovers' return was the best one.
You were quite convincing.
I'll probably use that.
No,
he
wasn't, Gordon.
What part of that did I give it away?
Gave it away when you mentioned driving Alec Higgins home because you've tilted a foreign super scoreboard, Gordon. I can promise you.
I
that.
Know, but which one of the Betty's hot pot was not believable?
When he said they put it in for 30 minutes because she used to put it in for 40.
True. That's sad. He's got you bang to rights.
The
well
recipe
done.
Was bang on.
Well
lamb,
done to John. £250 better off. What are you thinking about the new season, John, from a Rangers perspective? You've signed Jose Cifuentes tonight.
I'm happy with that, but I think I don't know if he'll maybe play three at the back, I think, Bill.
Oh.
Because I think the forwards he's brought in are more central, and I think that's going to free up Tav and Yilmaz either side, so I wouldn't be surprised if he goes with three at the back Saturday.
Interesting that.
I've had a thought about that as well. We've got
yeah, but so who are you sort of sacrificing further up the pitch? Because something needs to give then.
Yeah. I think he's got the option of doing that, but at Rugby Park, he'll probably stick with his four. I don't think he'll experiment, but I think he's now got that good option of Golson, Balogun and Souter as three good, solid centre-backs, and it lets the two wing-backs go, but you would need to sacrifice someone in the middle of the park, I think.
That's going to be tough because Raskin and Cantwell, by all accounts, were big favourites last season. You've added Cifuentes and Kieran Dowell and various others to the mix. So what happens there, Mark? Can you see it? Or would that be more of an in-game
maybe an in-game thing. Yeah, change, because certainly Michael Beale needed a plan B. You know, what I was chatting about the other night, that Rangers fans going along are so used to seeing the formation with one guy through the middle and two wider ones, or somebody just coming in narrow on the right-hand side. That I think there's going to be a big change. I don't know if he'll change to a three right away, but he's certainly got options like that, as pointed out. The centre-backs there are covered. The width is obviously, even if it is a four, is going to come from your full-backs because, like John was saying there, most of those players have been brought in are more centralised. So it just depends on the opposition. If he wants to really overload that midfield area, yeah, well, you could probably see, you know, Tavernier and Yilmaz or Barisic playing wide and putting your more creative players in that middle area.
Thank you very much, John. It was good to hear from you, and you've won £250 thanks to Gordon Dalziel not remembering which stories he's told before. Congratulations, John.
Cheers, thanks very
good, man.
Well done, John.
What a night at Easter Road. The good news or the bad news?
I go bad news. You all get bad news out the road first.
Bad news. Hibs are on to their third goalkeeper of the night.
No way.
Another injury.
So we big analysis on David Marshall. He kept his place, except he didn't, because he got injured in the warm up. And Jojo Wallacott came in for his debut. He's now injured after 18 minutes. Ooh. And here's a famous goalkeeping name for you. Boric has come on.
It's not Arthur's son, is it?
No, it's a relation though. Is it nephew or cousin? I can't remember which one. But yeah.
You've got to give some good news.
Oh, they've scored again. Right, Martin Boyle. Yeah.
Martin Boyle again.
Mm-hmm. 2-0. Home and host, are we?
Game done.
You happy with that?
Yep.
Well, happy to see our teams progress in Europe. It's nothing more embarrassing when, you know, we make such a song and dance about teams qualifying for Europe and how we have to go through these qualifiers and it's unfair. And then we always trip up at the first hurdle. So, well done, Hibs. Well, game's not over. Yes, only 18 minutes in.
Surely. Right, let's play this stuff from Graeme Souness because I think it is... It's very interesting stuff, and actually it would be nice to maybe have done it a bit earlier, but I must admit we're just a very busy show tonight trying to give away money and so on. Maybe once you've digested this you could call us between now and the end of the show, maybe even tomorrow night. So Graeme Souness, he has been speaking recently to our colleague Ewan Cameron on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. You'll remember throughout the summer there was talks about maybe a return to the club and in what role, would it be like director of football and so on. Let's hear what he had to say on why he's not back at Rangers.
I had a couple of meetings with James Bisgrove, but ultimately decided it wasn't for me. I felt, you know, I had something to offer, but maybe it wasn't seen as a road they wanted to go down from their point.
So you,
I'm a great believer. You can never have enough football people around a place. You know, I look at the likes of most recent example. That would be Ted Bowie at Chelsea, where you've got someone new coming in and not having any football around them, any football knowledge around them. And they made lots of mistakes. I mean, Ed Woodward at Man U after Fergie went, he was making all the big football calls. And look how well they did with that. I mean, the game is littered with it. You've got Mashiri at Everton. They had Ellis Short at Sunderland, Mel Morris at Derby. You know, there's a whole litany of people who, smart people going into football clubs and not getting it right. I felt that like something to offer, but it wasn't the way they wanted to go.
What's your interpretation of that, Mark? What's happened there?
Oh, it's a tough one. Well, I think taking from it right away is when you heard Graeme Souness linked to the job, me personally, I thought it was just speculation, like people putting two and two together that he'd left Sky Sports and maybe Rangers needed someone in that role and people were jumping to conclusions. There's certainly truth in it. The fact that he's had, you know, several meetings with James Bisgrove tells a story. It's hard to think why Rangers wouldn't want to go down that road. I think Graeme Souness makes a good point there. He's certainly done his homework and he's been involved in the English game a long time and seen it firsthand, the owners coming in and chief execs making big decisions, which he says maybe a lack of football knowledge. But maybe, you know, Bisgrove and Beals got together and thought, we don't want somebody maybe undermining the manager. Graeme Souness is a really powerful character and he may just have overshadowed the work Michael Beale's done.
More specifically, Gordon, I wonder if it sounds maybe that what Rangers thought Graeme Souness's role could be was different from what Graeme Souness thought Graeme Souness's role could be. Is that fair?
I think Graeme's went in with the idea of being solely involved with the football side of it. And I think Rangers, like Mark has said, has decided that was not going to be his role.
And so it is speculation, but Rangers were thinking along the lines more of ambassadorial, whereas Graeme Souness thinks a real hands-on football operational role.
I think Graeme would have brought bags of experience. He knows the club. He was very successful at the club. He's a very strong figure. I think he's a very good football man. And I do agree with him. I think that when I was listening to Graeme there, I do agree with the fact that you can't get enough guys with experience, especially what Graeme
does. Depend what role though, doesn't it?
Yeah, well,
because for as much as he's right to say you shouldn't just shoehorn other people into jobs that would be good for football men, as the phrase always goes, if it is director of football, that nowadays is a pretty skilled role at big clubs. You're generally talking about overseeing sports science departments, overseeing youth academy structures, overseeing all sorts of stuff. And whilst Graeme Souness has a wealth of knowledge and experience at having played and managed football, that doesn't necessarily mean that you're right for that role, does it?
Yeah. Listen, there's so much comes with these director of football roles. Quite often, it is people that we've rarely heard of that take up these roles that have maybe got a bit more of a business background. I still think that Graeme Souness probably would be suited to that role. I think he's been in and around the game long enough that a very top level. But obviously, Michael Beale and Bisgrove got together and thought it just wasn't right.
What do you make of it, Rangers fans? Are you disappointed to hear that the way that ended? Would you have liked to have seen Graeme Souness back at the club in some capacity, or trust the way things are heading? Do let us know right now and we'll try and get you on next. Mark Wilson and Gordon Dalziel are here on 01419511025, and there is still time for you to get in touch. Please do, maybe on those Graeme Souness comments that we heard just before the break, because I think they were very interesting indeed, saying that he did hold talks with James Bisgrove over the summer, but it sounds like what Rangers wanted him to do and what he wanted to do was a bit different. And you know, he's expressing his disappointment at that. Crazy Horse on Twitter says, sounds like he wanted a director of football role rather than an ambassadorial one. GM though says, trust Bisgrove on this. And Champions 55 says, he'd have got my vote for director of football. You need people like Souness and Ferguson around our club, real winners with real winning mentality. That's half the battle. And it just comes down to personal preference. See, if we are talking director of football, I get why fans love that stuff and feel that way. I would also completely sympathise with anyone who says winning mentality is not that important for your director of football, or it would be nice to have, but it's not like the number one skill set required.
Yeah, probably not. There's a lot needed to be a director of football, but like, we don't know what Graeme Souness has behind him in that respect. Sure. I know he's been there in the forefront of football for a long time, but who knows what he's done with his downtime. But it depends what James Bisgrove wanted him to do. Did he want him to be an ambassador and go around the lounges and be the face for Rangers?
If he's only asked to do the halftime draw, he's probably not wanted it. But we don't know.
Exactly.
But I think it's pretty safe to say, though, they had different ideas, isn't it? On what? Well,
obviously, such a big name, though, that it's right to make news, because I think there would have been a large or a percentage of the Rangers fans that would have wanted him. But equally, Gordon, like you said, there would have been some that thinks, no, Rangers have to go in a different direction, mm-hmm. and be more modern and forward-thinking rather than hark back to the past.
Everybody's got to think the same. When you make decisions like that, everybody's got to be singing off the same hymn sheet. There's no doubt in that. But obviously Rangers wanted Graeme Souness a different role. He was looking at more hands-on the football department because of his experience, because you heard him talk about other clubs that didn't have football experience guys round about and the failures. But it's unfortunate, because I think Graeme Souness going into Rangers in some capacity would have been a good move.
So the role is still then outstanding. What James Bisgrove wanted to fill is still outstanding.
Well, so is the director of football.
So when does that get addressed? I know fans
are sporting director, I think Rangers called it previously. But
fans generally really only care about transfers, players coming in to work the first day of the season. But in the wider picture, you know, things like that are really important to get right.
Yeah, but I don't think it, the full operation shuts down. You still be a head of recruitment team. The sporting director goes sort of above that.
If you're looking at the bigger picture further down the line, not instant impact just now. I'm talking about next season's transfers.
Because some clubs don't even have them.
Of course,
don't have that structure.
I think the modern game now, the bigger clubs tend to have them. So The hunt still goes on, and I'm sure Rangers fans will want it filled sooner rather than
Hibs
later.
Are cruising 3-0 up now. Christian Doidge's overhead kick. You guys thought it was sort of over already. Any doubt whatsoever?
No.
Just a matter how many, yeah?
Yeah, I think it'll be a good night for Hibs.
Yeah, I mean, they've got a cushion now, a two-goal cushion, and I can't see it necessarily changing. A bit of drama, though. They're on their third goalkeeper of the night, remember. But other than that, going to be straightforward.
Yeah, and it gives them a confidence booster going into the first game of season Sunday.
Against this hanging over them.
Yeah, and it's sort of home as well. So the only problem for Lee Johnston is to make sure that how he progresses through the game. He's obviously comfortable. Get one or two of your main players off. Make sure they're okay for a weekend, because you want to start a new season with 3 points, and it's got to be a difficult game against St Mirren.
Yeah, Luzerne 0, Dewar Gardens 0. The winner, Hibs would face the winner if they go through. So 2-1 to Luzerne on aggregate there. So it looks like Hibs will do the business. They've got Boric in goal now, the third goalkeeper of the night. So we would expect them to see that through, and we can react to it tomorrow night. Right, how much are you looking forward to the new season? It is the last time we will speak to you two until Saturday, when it all kicks off.
Yeah, miss Saturdays, miss being in the studio, miss seeing the action come in, and it's upon us right away. I think the positives about a new season, first day of the new season, is seeing team selections and new players coming to our country, some of which we've seen very rarely coming from different clubs all around Europe.
who will catch your eye and will be chatting about probably come player of the year time next May. You know, that's just the way it. Look at Van Veen. I know he was there before, but they just go to a different level. So thoroughly looking forward to it.
Me take Hearts tonight, something I didn't tell you about earlier. Kyosuke Tagawa, a Japanese international, a 4-year deal for a 6-figure fee. So that's a bit of a statement, won that from Hearts.
Yeah, the Edinburgh clubs seem to be spending the cash. So it'll be interesting to see how Hearts do this season. I think it's a big season for them. They carry a big support, obviously, and especially at home, they pack out their home games.
Who's the manager there? No, that's another thing. We've got such a unique situation.
That's a scenario.
Don't ask that with a minute left of the show, will you?
Yeah, but I think it'll be a big season for both Edinburgh clubs. I think they've invested heavily into their teams now. It'll be interesting to see how that goes. And then you've obviously got Aberdeen, because I think we've all got Celtic, Rangers, Celtic.
What are we doing? Are we revealing predictions on Saturday for you two?
He's been copying me left, right and centre. It's really incredible. I'm feeling a bit embarrassed for him.
How was your first night with the cameras on you? Because we were really worried about you.
Yeah.
We thought honestly that the pressure, the spotlight had genuinely got too much for you, and that's why you didn't come in on Tuesday.
Yeah, so
I pulled
a sickie from school.
So you could do your homework.
I've enjoyed the studio. I've enjoyed everything about it. Very comfortable. When you get to my age, I think the seats are...
See, I like to stand.
Do you? Yeah, Mark likes to stand.
Is there no option of us two standing? And I'm
I'll
sitting there.
Imagine you and I stand and all you see is here, the midriff, and Gordon just left sat on his own.
I think we should do it week about. Can we not do that? Stand a week, sit a week.
Well, the desk's too low to stand.
Oh, so it is. I forget that then.
Yeah, I've enjoyed my night. It's
this
great to
way.
Be back. I can't
I've
wait for Saturday.
Night. Like he's an OAP for the night at the bingo. Yeah. Well done, that's right.
I'm getting home
you
with
can
my supper.
Well, we are almost done. Thank you, as always, for your company. Thank you for your calls, your tweets. Thanks to those of you who just listen patiently at home, as always. We really do appreciate it every night, and we're back tomorrow. The new season eve, if you like, with Hugh Keevans. Hope he's not got another tuxedo on, and Kenny Miller. So make sure you join us from 6 o'clock tomorrow. And that is the final straight Saturday. It all returns, all of those boring Saturday afternoons across the summer will be a thing of the past, and the league action will kick off again. Thanks to Mark and Gordon. Thanks to you once more. We're back at 6 tomorrow.